طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We inshallah start our weekly class, which is explaining some narrations from the Book of Bulugh AlMaram. And today inshallah we'll talk about chapter which is discussing the sutrah, or which is, you know, it's a partition or something which will be put in front of the one who is praying to prevent people from walking in front of him while he is praying. The first hadith was narrated by Abu Jahim ibn al-Harith radiyallahu anhu, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو يعلم المار بين يدي المصلي ماذا عليه من الإثم لكان أن يقف أربعين خيرا له من أن يمر بين يديه. متفق عليه, واللفظ للبخاري. Narrated Abu Juhaym ibn al-Harith radiyallahu anhu, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if the person who passed in front of another person in prayer knew the magnitude of his sin, he would rather wait for 40 rather than pass in front of him. This hadith agreed upon. That means it was reported by Al-Imam Al-Bukhari wal-Imam Muslim rahimahumullah ta'ala. Now when the hadith said 40, in the hadith itself it was not explained this 40. Is it 40 days? Is it 40 months? Is it 40 years? Is it 40 seasons? It was not clear here. In some other narration said 40 kharifan, which is 40 season, which refers to 40 years, and Allah knows. But the point here, it's not the exact number of the years or the time, but to show you, you know, how much it is, you know, very major sin or big sin that the person walk in front of a person who is praying. And let's go to the explanation of the Sheikh. Said, if, and this is condition, if the one who knows this, then he will prefer that he wait. That means he doesn't go and cross in front of the person who is praying. That's maybe easier for him to stay and wait 40 years waiting instead of going in front of the person who is praying. This to show you how much this is very serious. And this from al-mubalagha, that means just as exaggeration, just to show you how much it is not right to do this thing. So from this hadith, the ulama conclude that it is forbidden to anyone to walk in front of the one who is in prayer. If there's somebody praying and there is, you know, the distance from the place while he's standing to the point where he put his front on the ground for sujood, that's mean the area the person needs when he pray, this in fact the design or designated area for him to pray. So nobody should go and cross in front of him while he was praying. It doesn't matter if this prayer is his fard, obligatory salah, or nafila. Because in the hadith, this hadith, he said the one who pray and didn't mention what type of prayer. So anyone who was praying, we should respect this and nobody should go and pass in front of him. This either in the masjid, at home, outside, wherever it is, then it is haram, as the Sheikh said, تحريم المرور بين يدي المصلي. It is forbidden to show that this act is forbidden. It's not allowed, not lawful for anyone to go in front of the person who is praying. And the sin is very great, because the Prophet ﷺ said that this person, if he knows what the, you know, the result of what he's doing, then he will prefer to wait, no matter how long he's waiting, till this person finishes salah instead of going in front of him. Also, from this hadith, it didn't mention if this musalli, the one who is praying, is he praying alone as a single, or is he praying as imam, or is he, if he is praying as ma'mum. So anyone who is praying, then it's not lawful to go in front of him. But in other narrations, in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the ma'mum was excluded. What does it mean? Because the ma'mum, the one who is praying behind the imam is considered as his sutrah, as a partition. So if somebody walk in front of the one between the person who is praying and his imam, this, if it was need for it, like for example, a person, he came late and then he found there is gap in one line, and he want to go to get and fill that gap, and there's no way to do this except that he's walking in front of those people who are praying behind the imam, then it's okay. You see, also it was mentioned in other hadith that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, in Mina, one time he was walking, you know, front people were praying. So the ulama said, as the Sheikh said, فَقَدْ دَلَّتُ السُنَّةَ عَلَى السِّثْنَاءِ. There's some narrations which show that the one who is praying behind the imam, his imam will be, you know, the sutra will be in front of the imam, because Ibn Abbas, he walk behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and front of people who are praying behind him. You see, that means he walk between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and people who are praying behind him. And he didn't say that their salah is not right, or he blamed Ibn Abbas about this. So ulama said that, you know, for one who is walking in this situation, but as we said, if it's needed, then it will not nullify the salah of the people who are doing this. But it's not right to do it, you know, except if there is necessity. Like for example, when we talk about haram in Mecca and Medina, and if the person try to get out or get in and there's no way but to walk, you know, between lines, then we said it is okay. It is okay. But if he try his best to avoid it, that's mean try, if there's any way to go even around, to stay away from walking in front of the people while they are playing, while they are praying, then this is the right choice that he should do. But in case that he was stuck inside between the lines and he cannot get out but through these lines, then it will say it's okay. A person who is in salah, for example, following the imam, and then something happened to him. Let's say that he nullified his wudu because, you know, he break his best wind, or some blood come out from his nose and he want to leave the line, then, and there is no way except that he walk in front of these lines. We say this is necessity and that is okay. Now, طيب. Another hadith, the next hadith is said, وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت سئل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة تبوك عن سترة المصلي فقال مثل مؤخرة الرحل. أخرجه الإمام Muslim. Narrated, Aisha radiallahu anha, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, that means somebody asked him, during the expedition of Tabuk about the sutra of the one who is praying, he said something such as the back of the saddles. The back of saddles, you know, this, you know, seat that people put in the ride, like the camel or the horse, it's the same size, which means it's not that big, something that you use it. This is the distance. And this, inshallah, will explain here. Now, who is the one who asked? It was not mentioned in the hadith. The Prophet was asked. So sometimes, you'll find in some hadith, there is no mention about the questioner. Who is he or who he was? Why? Because there is no need to know who is he. You see, the point here is what he asked, the question and the answer, not the identity of the person who asked. And this, my dear brothers, to teach us always that sometimes there are some certain details that people try hard and work hard to know it and dig in, you know, deep to try to ask why and how and who. And there is no benefit from knowing this. I mean, what benefit you will get from this? The most important is what? Is what you can do based on this knowledge. This is why sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when people ask him questions, they give them an answer they don't expect. For example, a person, he said, "Mata as-sa'a?" When is the time for the hour? Now he expected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to tell him, you know, after such years or after. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, answer him by another question. He said, "Wamada a'adatta laha?" What did you prepare for that time? So it's not important to know when is the time of the end of the world, because we all believe that there will be an end for this world, and only Allah Azza wa Jal know this time. The important thing is, and what we can do is, what did we prepare for that minute or that point when we leave this world? So this is always, it's not necessary sometimes to know all the details. The important thing is that we know what can we do with the knowledge that we got according to this. Now, so the sutra, this is now the size of the sutra. What is the size of the partition that the person needed to put? It is something that he put in front of him to the point that he put his head. So it will not make it very large. So it will make it very difficult for people, especially if the place is tight or small and take that much, you know, space. But he should put it in front of him to the point that he covered the area where he prayed. And this is what we see it, you know, the masajid now. You see this carpet, which was designed to give the person, you know, the chance to pray, you know, in lines. The same thing, this carpet we carry, or what we call a sujada, it's almost like a sutra because it's designed the space where we are praying. Now, what are the benefits of this? First of all, to protect the one who praying from other people. So people, when they come, they know that this person is praying and this is the area or the space that he need to use. Therefore, we go behind it. So he should put something, and this is like partition, you know, to let people move behind it. Also, it will help the person when he is praying to concentrate in his salah. How? Because when he pray, he will concentrate on the area where he will use, in a state of looking, you know, around or in front. And we know that it is of the sunnah, which is recommended, that the person, when he's praying, he should look always when he's standing at the spot where he's going to put his face or his front when at the time prostration. So this is also will keep the person away from looking around and give him more khushu. Also, when the person, whenever you put a sign for you or sutra partition, this will make you feel comfortable that nobody will disturb you. Nobody will disturb you, and he come and walk and he didn't notice that if you are paying or not. At least you will see something to protect yourself. Now, the next hadith, which was عن صبر بن عبد الجهني قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليستتر أحدكم في الصلاة ولو بسهم. When one of you prays, he should put a sutra, a partition or a sign of partition, in front of him, even if it is only an arrow. That means it's very tiny thing, small stick. You know, the arrow is small stick or stick, very thin, and it is the same. So at least you put something in front of you, like a stick or anything, to show people that you are praying. And this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, liyastatir. It's like a command. So this is why some ulama, they said, putting sutra is wajib. But as we said, from other narrations, we understand that this command, if we notice that in other narrations, it was violated, then it will become, we turn it not wajib, but it will be sunnah and highly recommended. Now, so al-amru lil-istihbab, al-amru lil-istihbab, that means it is recommended, it is liked to be done. But the Sheikh is, you know, turn our attention to a very important point. Now, some people now, whenever they hear any command, they say, it is wajib or sunnah. Now, the Muslim always, you know, always he eager to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no need to ask if it is wajib or sunnah, unless, you know, if there's, you need to know the hukum or something that, you know, needed in this regard. But as long as there's command from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and we can do it, then we should not hesitate to do this. And as we said, this issue have different views for ulama. Some of them, they said, this is wajib. And others, they said it is sunnah. Now, and as we mentioned before, because it was mentioned that Ibn Abbas from other hadith, which we mentioned about Ibn Abbas, to show that this is not wajib. Also, we learn from this hadith that as-sutratu mashru'a li kulli musallin. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't mention that when you pray fariḍa, but he said if anyone of you pray, then he should put something in front of him as partition to protect him from somebody go in front of him. Now, the next hadith, which relates to what are the things, types of things that if it was a gun or somebody in front of the person who's praying, that nullify his salah. Because we should understand that walking in front of the person who is praying has certain rules. Some rules relate to the one who is walking and crossing in front of the one who is praying. And we said he is committing sin. And it is not an easy sin, because the Prophet ﷺ said that he will prefer, if he knows, you know, how big is the sin that he is doing, or how serious is doing the violation that he did, then he will prefer to wait 40 years before he jump on and walk in front of the person who is praying. So these rules are related to the one who is crossing. But how about the one who is praying? Is there anything? Does his prayer will be affected by somebody who is walking in front of him? This explained in the next hadith, which was narrated by Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu. An Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu qal Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqta'u salat al-rajul al-muslim إذا لم يكن بين يديه مثل مؤخرة الراحل المرأة والحمار والكلب الأسود. When any of you stands for prayer and there's nothing in front of him as sutra, as we said, as partition, then his prayer would be cut off. That means will be nullified by this action if certain thing happened or walk in front of him. One of these are women. If a person is praying and there is no sutra in front of him, or there is a sutra and walk between him and his sutra, or there is no sutra, then this woman will cut off his prayer. That means his prayer is not valid and he should resume his prayer again. It doesn't matter who is this lady. Maybe she is your wife, maybe she is your sister, maybe she is your mother, any woman, because it didn't mention in the hadith any types or of relation, but he said a woman. So a woman, if he crossed, this will break the salah, and then you need to resume the salah again. So this is very, very, very important to know. This is why it's very important for the person to make it easy for people to move around him, to put sutra, to put partition, to put a sign that, look, I need this space for my prayer. So nobody should come in front of me. And when he put the sutra, that means he make partition like a special place, and then people, they can move around and behind this sutra. As you know, other things, which is maybe in cities, we may not encounter this at homes or at masajid, but when you are in a desert or towns or villages, there are some animals that go around. Or people who are, for example, in troubling, and in their way, they stop to pray, and there's some animals roaming around. So like a dog, if the dog, the black dog, also, this will cut off the salah. Or an ass, or a donkey, doesn't matter, is it zebra or a donkey, which is used in the village, then all these also will cut the salah. The hadith mentioned the black dog. So some of the sahaba, they said, how about the red one or the white one or different color? Doesn't cut the salah, because the hadith mentioned exactly the black dog. Why it is the black? And then the narration, it said, the black dog is a devil. So this is doesn't mean, you know, that he's an animal or shaitan in a form of animal he came, or because this is very aggressive usually for any reason. We just take it as it is. So if any of these pass in front of the person who is praying, this, as we said, will cut his salah. And this is why it is very important to keep and protect our salah by having these sutra. Now, some ulama, they concluded from this hadith that it is better to avoid using or buying the black dog. The black dog. So it's not right to hunt it, to have it, or to use it, you know, like for, because it's not allowed anyway for a Muslim to have dog as puppy at his home. Okay, and put it as his home. That's not allowed. But in case, for example, for guards, it's allowed. For people who have cattle, like, you know, sheep or cows, and they help them in this matter. Or for farmers, it's allowed. It's okay. But also to avoid the black dog, according to this hadith. Now, maybe some people, they are, why it is the black dog? As we said, my dear brothers, it's very important. Allah Azza wa Jal is testing us sometimes in some command. And we don't know the answer. But since the hadith is authentic from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we took it, then we accept it, and then we believe what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, said to us, because there are many things that we cannot know about it, but Allah azza wa jalla know it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about it, and there's no need for us to know all this detail as I mentioned before. The next hadith, what talk about what should you do if you are praying and somebody want to walk in front of you. Is it okay to let him go or you should stop him? عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلى أحدكم إلى شيء يستره من الناس فأراد أحد أن يجتاز بين يديه فليدفعه فإن أبى فليقاتله فإنما هو شيطان. Narrated أبو سعيد الخدري, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, said, if anyone of you pray toward the sutra, as we said, he already, before he starts his prayer, he put a sign or partition or something in front of him to show that this is my space that I need for my prayer. So, sutra or barrier. And someone try to pass in front of him. That means pass between him and the line or the object that he placed to show that this is his area for prayer, or his barrier or partition. And someone tries to pass in front of him, then push him away. The person who is praying should push this person away. Don't let him to go in front of you. If he refuses, you know, some people, they come and they want to pass, then try to push him again. فَلْيُقَاتِلُوا, that means push him strongly. Push him away. If he refused, then fight him, for he is a devil. A devil doesn't mean that he's a devil, like Shaitan al-Rajim, but mean maybe his action, this is a devil, satanic action, or he was pushed by the Shaitan without his knowledge just to nullify the prayer of this person. This is why he should be pushed away. This is the point here. So this to show you, my dear brothers and sisters, it's very important how to put this barrier to keep you and keep your salah from something that is not, you know, it's not helping for you. No. So we learn from this hadith many points. First of all, we learn from this hadith that having sutra is not must. How? Because the hadith said, as you notice, it said here, if one pray, this hadith said, إِذَا صَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ إِلَى شَيْءٍ يَسْتُرُ. That means, if any of you prays toward a sutra barriers. So that means it could, you may pray without this sutra. So from this point, as we mentioned, we learn that it is sutra is not must, as some ulama has said it is must. This is one of the benefits that we learn from this hadith. Also, we learn from this hadith what the purpose of having this barriers or having this sutra or partition is, to keep people away from walking in front of you while you are praying, so you can concentrate in your prayer. We learn also from this hadith that it is permissible to push the person who want to walk in front of you. But we should be wise. For example, if a person that he ignorant, okay, idiot. Sometimes some people, they come, they don't care. And you are afraid that if you go and fight with him, then you will lose your salah. Then no benefit from fighting him. But you try your best to push him away. As we said before, if you are praying behind the imam and somebody walk in front of you, don't worry about this. Because now this is not yours, you know, your sutra is the imam. The sutra of the imam, the barrier of the imam, not the area between you and the line or the imam in front of you. So here, and especially my dear brothers and sisters, when you are at haram, I notice sometimes in haram, especially in Ramadan, while it's crowded, some people, they try to apply this hadith literally. Literally, that means they practice it strongly. So if somebody come in the lines and there's no way to go, so they will fight him. And maybe they punch him in his face. So he will not let him go. And this is ignorant, in fact. This is ignorant. Because first of all, since you are praying in lines, so there is no harm, somebody walk in front of you. Here we are talking about a person like imam, he's putting sutra, you know, or putting barriers, or a sign that in front of him. This is the point. If you are praying alone, anywhere, and you put an object to show that this is the area of my prayer, then and somebody come to pass, then it's okay to push him away. To push him away. If he try hard to push him away. But as we said, if it's come to the point that he will push you and move you from your way and you know turn you away from the Qibla, and then it will be start big fighting, there's no need to do it. And anyway, this will not, inshallah, break your salah because it's not in your hand. Now, we learn from this hadith that if you have no sutra, if you have no barriers in front of you, no sign, then you have no right to push people. Why? Because you didn't put sign for them that this, please, don't walk between me and the object or the sign or the barriers that I put in front of me to show my space for my salah. Since you didn't do this, then don't blame others when they are walking because they don't know what you are doing. So this is here, the condition is that if somebody put a sutra, which is partition, but if he didn't put a partition and somebody come in front of you, you have no right to fight. Now, okay, if there's somebody want to just, he's not passing, but he wasn't take something in front of the one who's praying. Is it okay? No problem with this. But we said it will be better to be avoided. Why? Because this maybe will keep the mind of the person who's praying is busy, thinking, looking around. So it's better not to do it. Now. The next hadith, let's go to the meaning of the hadith, translation. Narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when one of you prays, he should place something in front of him. This is a command from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He should place something in front of him. If he cannot find anything, he should set up a stick in front of him. If he doesn't have a stick, he should draw a line on the ground in front of him. Then nothing that pass in front of him will harm him. This to show you how much important to have this partition or this sutra or this barrier that he put between you and others who are, you know, roaming around. That even if you didn't find anything to put, at least if you put a line. Like for example, you are in desert or outside and you put a line in the ground. So the sutra, it is better to be something that an object that have some height. But if you have nothing like this, at least put sign that you, this is the space where you are using for your salah. Now, and also here we learn that we should get the best or the better. That means if you have a stick, you don't move to drawing a line. If you have something better than a stick, an object, then it's better also to use it. And it was usually, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always he had a small stick he used. So whenever he pray, always he will stick it in the ground in front of him and make it as sutra or partition for him. Also, we learn from this hadith that when you are praying, then the sutra should be in front of you, not in the right side, not in the left side, but in the front of you exactly. Now, there's some narration which said the one should not face the partition or the book that he put as partition for him exactly. But this hadith is da'if. And there's hadith that said that if anyone is praying to his partition or the object that he placed as partition, he should not stick exactly in front of it, but he should go a little bit right or a little left. But this hadith, as we mentioned, or the ulama said that this hadith is da'if, da'if, weak. So there no harm that if you put something that you pray to this. And as we said, that the line is enough. Like for now, nowadays, for example, this we have this carpet, sujada, we take. And you put this sujada in the ground, and people, they know that this area is for your prayer. This is the end or the edge of this sujada or this carpet will be considered as your sutra if you have nothing to put in front of you. Because it will do the same, I mean, the same purpose for this. And the last hadith عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقطع الصلاة شيء وادرأوا ما استطعتم. Prayer is not invalidated by anything but push away, you know, to the best of your ability. But this hadith ضعيف, because we mention the hadith which is authentic, that the woman, if she passes in front of the person who is praying, this will cut up his salah. So from here we finish this chapter, which talk about the partition of the one who is praying, and we try to cover all the all this hadith, and inshallah we'll next week inshallah we'll talk about the importance of khushu' in salah and all narrations related to that subject. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all safe in this crisis of the coronavirus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the Muslim wherever they are, and also save the humanity, the whole world from this bandit. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We are, alhamdulillah, in this country, inshallah, safe, and the government, the authority, they are doing whatever they can to protect us, to protect our health. In fact, we should appreciate what the Minister of Health is doing. Doctors, nurses, all those brothers and sisters, they are fighting in the front line for us. We should help them by staying at home. This is the advice of every doctor, every nurse, every medical specialist. Always they say, if you want us to help us, you can help us in two ways. The first, that you stay at home, and the important thing is to make dua for us. So we make dua for all our brothers and sisters in the medical field, that may Allah protect them and help them and give them strength to defeat this virus. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all Muslims wherever they are, and also get the whole world, inshallah, very soon, be safe from this virus. But also we should learn many lessons, inshallah, from this think just to one of them, remember the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, people are staying at home. And at home, you remember the many blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal give you before. Now you are isolated at home. Health is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Safety and security in the land, this is also a major, a very, very great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should be very thankful for Allah, because if we, you know, give thanks to Allah, Allah will increase us from His bounty. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All brothers and sisters who have any questions, please don't forget to place it in the comments, and inshallah I will write answer for every question, and other brothers also and sisters, they can check these comments to find questions and answer related to this subject. جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.